we are small, we are mighty. And our first tradition is always to invite you to just get up and greet each other and pass the keys. We do it now so that it doesn't disrupt the flow of the worship experience later. And also, we almost always have visitors, so we really like to make everybody feel welcome. So if you see somebody you don't recognize, please help them to feel welcome. And if you're new, you'll probably not recognize anybody, so, you know, say hello to anybody you want to. Please try to clap. Church. so I was happy to have him help in that way. Other announcements, yes.
Is the women's group meeting Wednesday? It's the last Wednesday of the month.
I believe so, yes.
Here at 10:30.
All right, here at 10:30, women's group meeting, right after Lori's fitness class. And I think we're going to be sending out cards, you know, greeting cards to some of our kids who are away. So the other thing is, if you have a member of your family, a young person who's either stationed out in the world or at college or has just moved out of the house and is a young adult launching themselves, please send us those names and addresses so that we can send out cards and greetings from the church to them soon.
The weigh station could really use some winter hats and gloves now. Now that we're getting into the colder season, we've got a few, but I know that our guests will surely be in need of those. So if you have any extras around the house, they could surely be used.
All right, so the weigh station is the Valley's only actual response to homelessness here in this region. So in the first 3 months that we've been open, we are not a shelter. It's a day resource center. It's another initiative of multiple churches and nonprofits in the Valley working together. We've already served at least 50 people in 3 months. We are rural areas. That would not sell them a big number, but it is a small percentage of those who are actually homeless. But we're starting to see the patterns of what homelessness looks like here in the Valley. And as you said, we run on donations and volunteers. So we're going to be training volunteers on Monday, November 4th. Meanwhile, we're always collecting canned goods, and we're very happy to receive things for cold weather as weather sets in. We have families living in cars, hopefully not anymore. Most of them have found some other type of shelter, but there are people that live in tents year-round here in the Valley, if you can imagine what that's like with 5 feet of snow. Other announcements that are more cheerful for the lady, but... Well, I'm going to remind you that next Sunday afternoon we have the privilege of hosting the Silver Lake Singers for a concert at, I believe, 4 o'clock. Oh, 3 o'clock, sorry, I didn't put that wrong. 3 o'clock in the afternoon, and it will be rather an All Souls, All Saints kind of celebration. We welcome you to join us for that as well. All right. Are you guys looking for hearing stuff, Alex? Do you have those? Okay. Well then, I believe we're done with announcements. And we are happy to have you all here. And I would ask that you please rise for the first hymn. Psalm 57, I sing the mighty power of God. If you're new, this will be a different experience, and if you've been coming, you'll know that we're sort of having this experiment. We did a whole worship series on how to meet God through the food in the scripture, food that's been made by butchers and bakers and fresh food makers. And so we're having this meditation each week on a different element. This week, the element you'll discover is salt. And we sing a refrain from a hymn called Taste and See. It's very easy. And then as we play that music underneath the reading of our call to worship, and then we'll sing again that refrain to close it out. So let's give that a try and see how it goes. Thank you. enduring, that is forever, and that you will be with us through it all, and even beyond that. We pray for our bodies changed by the diagnoses, from Alzheimer's and stroke to cancer and diabetes and so many other complications. We pray for those who are in recovery and are healing, who have received good news. We pray with gratitude for such outcomes. We pray also for those who are on a journey that is mortal and vulnerable. We pray too for the places in the world where your presence is so needed, places that experience violence and oppression, that experience setbacks because of natural disasters. We pray especially in this church for our sister church, the Chikanga Church in the city of Mutare in the nation of Zimbabwe. But we pray for all of your children of all faiths, because we are all children of light and children of God. May you find us wherever we are and be with us. And may you guide those who make decisions that affect all of us. And may you be with those who are called into harm's way, wherever they may be, as their light and their shield. We ask you now to hear our silence. Listen as we speak to you now in words that you first taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom. Please know that no matter how you say that prayer, God understood it first. It was in your hearts before it was ever on your lips. We come from many traditions, and all of them are sacred in the sight of God. May you come forward to read the scripture.
Good morning. This morning we have some brief readings on salt. From Leviticus chapter 2, verse 13. You shall not omit from your grain offerings the salt of the covenant with your God. With all your offerings you shall offer salt. And from Numbers chapter 18, verse 19. It is a covenant of salt forever before the Lord, for you and your descendants as well. And from the New Testament, Gospel of Matthew, chapter 5, verses 13 to 16. You are the salt of the earth, but if salt has lost its taste, how can its saltiness be restored? It is no longer good for anything, but is thrown out and trampled underfoot. You are the light of the world. A city built on a hill cannot be hid. No one, after lighting a lamp, puts it under the bushel basket, but on the lampstand, and it gives light to all in the house.
Now, normally I don't even rely on notes, but I do have some statistics today, so I may end up looking at a piece of paper for just a little bit. But I want to begin again our meditation with salt by thinking about its presence in the scripture and what that means in the larger cultural context that you heard both in the Hebrew scriptures and then again in the gospel. Salt is a very ancient and essential commodity in the culture of human life. In point of fact, life cannot exist and yet our bodies do not produce salt. We have about the same amount of salt in our bodies that you'll find in the ocean. In an average-sized person, and I'm not sure if we decided what was average, maybe 40 teaspoons of sodium chloride. Why is salt essential to life, both as a culture and in our body? It was used as a preservative. It made food last. Not that it only tastes a little better, but people could preserve food in all kinds of weather because, one, it dehydrated the food, and then it also, in higher concentrates, prevented the growth of bacteria. It was used to fertilize fields. And animals were finding salt licks before humans even realized exactly what was going on. But humans have always had salt in their diet. Salt helps our nerves transmit impulses that help our muscles beat. We literally cannot exist without salt to help transfer messages in our body. Salt also influences our fluid balance, it's an electrolyte. So it helps regulate our bodies in a bunch of different ways. And so if you think about it, when somebody has exerted themselves or is in an extreme physical condition, what kind of fluid might they hook you up to at the hospital? A saline drip. And what might an athlete use in order to prepare for and then recover from a marathon? Our friend used pickle juice or pickle brine. But guess what? Gatorade was developed out of the history of using pickle brine for athletes who needed to recover from extreme dehydration. They noticed that the pickle brine was very helpful, and out of that came the basis of all these other sports fluids that we now use to replenish our electrolytes. Without salt, our bodies would fail. It even regulates our senses of touch, taste, and sight. So when you're dehydrated, the way you think changes, your senses become dull, and your muscles literally don't function. So imagine how important salt is, and yet, it's not always easy to acquire. There are three ways to get salt. The easiest one is to evaporate it out of something like the ocean or a salt lake, right? The sun will take away the fluid and leave behind the salt. So the most coveted salt in salty bodies of water is the salt that floats on top, and the less desirable is what's down in the seabed. But we can also mine salt. So when it's left behind, right, there are entire ancient seabeds up in the mountains, like in Himalayas, right? And it forms rather a crystalline or a rock-like structure. These are all examples of salt. These are slabs of salt mined in the mountains. But they're only found in really specific places, and it is an arduous task to collect salt. And so there are entire trade routes that were created around one salt to another, you know, one location of salt, transporting it either by caravan or on ships. It was used as a form of currency. Lord has an entire history of salt, or you print it out in the back so you can read all about salt and learn more than you ever wanted to know about salt. But it describes that there were entire blocks of salt used as coins. And in every commentary that I read on salt, the Roman soldiers were paid in part with salt. And so our word for salary is rooted in the same root word as salt. And from these valuations of salt as a currency, as a necessity in our lives, come phrases such as, worth his salt. A soldier was worth his pay if he was worth his salt. And if he wasn't worth his salt, he was not likely to stay in his service. In medieval times, because salt was still so valuable, your rank was based on whether you were seated above the salt or below the salt. Those who were wealthy or influential were seated above the salt. And in the, I think it's the 17th century, we start to use the phrase, take it with a grain of salt, as reference to whether something is true or not, or possibly the truth has been stretched and fabricated. Take my story with a grain of salt. And then there are these scriptural uses of salt. So again, we hear God saying, bring to every covenant making that we have, the sacred ritual where we will bind ourselves in covenant, the element of salt, because salt is the symbol of preserving and enduring faith. It is precious to life itself, and it will make something last, and it will bind it. And then Christ asks us to become salt of the earth, light of the world. And when he says that, it's not just figurative, and it's not just decorative. He's not talking about taking salt that you sprinkle on your food to make it taste better. He's not asking you to be something that's pretty or make things just the flavors pop a little bit. He asks you to be salt of the earth because you are essential to the life of this world, starting in your most intimate relationships and working outward into the community and into the world in whatever ways you may influence it. You are the salt of the earth. You are essential. You fertilize. You make things endure. You help transmit the messages. Help us think. Help us feel and sense and know. You find life. And without you, life cannot happen. Salt was found in one place, carried to another so that others might have life. You carry salt within you. You carry life within you. When we say someone's salt of the earth, it's a compliment. You are as authentic and as real and as vital as a person can be. And paired with that image is that you are light in the world. And in both cases, he asks, what happens? What happens if the salt isn't any good anymore? What makes it not be useful to us? And seeing with the light, what happens when the light goes out or we hide it? More like when we hide it. When we don't use the gifts that are given to us, when we don't share them and pass them along and let them burn in the world and change the world, we are not using the gifts that have been given to us by God. And each of us has a different gift that holy love has endowed us with. My gift is not the same as Meg's or Bob's or Catherine's. We each have special talents and strengths. And we need each other out in the world doing what we are able to do and doing that too in our own relationships, our own families, our own communities. Our salt and our light is needed everywhere. You are called to be salt. You are called to be light. because together we are the life of this world, and what we do and how we choose to do it will change everything for all the generations yet to come. We are at a point always of change and transformation. And we do it not just for ourselves, but as the covenant says, for our children and our children's children, that there may be a world for them to inherit and a dream for them to dream, just as there was for us. Where do you find God in the scriptures and in the food of the scriptures? Today, the part of the meal that is offered for you is salt and light. Thanks be to God. So just to, rub it in. This is an enthusiastic song, so let's try to, give it our own feet, rise for it. And we don't need to really have the whole thing at home. We're just going to do two verses. We're going to say, this little light of mine, and then the second verse is, I think, all the joy I have. This great joy I have. So if you don't want to hold the hymnal and you just want to sort of sway and be happy, feel free. Or you can hold the hymnal and check.
Thank you.
transformation in the world. And we ask that your holy love will transform these offerings that we have given today into the growth, the change, the mercy, and the justice that is needed here in the world. Be with us, one and all. Amen. Our final hymn this morning is the song 314, followed by a benediction which is printed in the bulletin. It's very easy to pick up that tune, so you can sing along as you're able. And then if you are willing and available, we'd love to have you come taste salt at a fellowship right after church. If not, go as salt and go as light, and I'll meet you at the front door. Of love.